Sajita,
yeah, you can start.
Okay, ma'am, with your permission, shall we start?
Yes, please.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Good evening, doctors. This is Dr. Someshwar from Shield Healthcare. I welcome you on behalf of Shield. Thank you very much for joining today's webinar. I request all the participants to post their questions in the comment box so that at the end of the webinar, we'll have a short Q&A session. So let me welcome today's our eminent speaker, Dr. Rajasri Sen Gupta, ma'am, who is a consultant obstetrician gynecologist at the Sen Gupta Hospital and Research Institute, Ravinagar Square, Nagpur. She's a teaching guide for MUHS recognized fellowship course in critical care obstetrics and worked as an assistant professor, Government Medical College, Nagpur for 5 years. And also she is a visiting clinician at Mayo Clinic, Arizona, USA. And she is a past secretary of NOGS Nagpur. And coming to the special awards and achievements, she awarded the FICOG at AACOG Bangalore 2019, and also presented paper at FIGO World Congress, and also a poster in North Zone Yuva Foxy, and delivered a prestigious UN NOGS oration, and won second prize for poster presentation at West Zone Yuva Foxy. And she is a keynote address on colposcopy screening at AACOG, and Leela Dubey Memorial Gold Medal for highest marks in Ops and Gynec at Medicine 3. And Pfizer Medallion of for University Topper at Medicine 1 and 2, and recipient of several gold medals and awards throughout the academic career. And she delivered various lectures at local, zonal, national conferences. Coming to the publications, she authored a chapter on preeclampsia in Foxy Focus and stroke in Eng, IMA-AMS Journal, and a pilot study of clinical biochemical and USG findings in PCOS in central India. Coming to the area of interest, adolescent reproductive health, conducted many lectures in various schools and colleges, and critical care obstetrics, runs the first obstetric critical care unit in central India. And coming to the gynecological surgery, third generation surgeon with expertise in various types of cancer. So with this, we welcome you for today's webinar, ma'am. And present webinar is streamed through Shield Connect, which is a digital initiative of Shield. So you will find all the webinars, the past and upcoming webinars, as well as if you want to find any the thought leaders webinars as well as their whereabouts, you can find today's speaker page, Dr. Rajasri Sen Gupta ma'am page, where you can find their webinars, and also you can also find the blogs, and also you have we have awareness page regarding PCOS, gynecological diseases, immune booster, COVID-19. So this is all about Shield Connect. And I request all the delegates, please do visit Shield Connect. If you miss any part of the program, it will be available in the Shield Connect. And coming to the today's topic, high blood pressure during pregnancy can affect the development of the placenta, causing the nutrients and oxygen supply to the baby to be limited. This can lead to early delivery or low birth weight, placental separation, and the other complication for the baby. So now, without wasting much time, let me turn over the time to Dr. Rajasri ma'am to talk on hypertension and its complication in pregnancy. Over to ma'am.
Thank you so much, Dr. Someshwar, for that kind introduction. May I share my screen now?
Yes, ma'am, you can share the screen.
Okay, just a moment, please. First of all, I must actually congratulate Shield Healthcare for this series of webinars that they have started. I mean, it's a really great, noble thing that they are doing by spreading all the education. And webinars are the best thing to do, I think, nowadays, because the world has all become virtual. And teaching and learning is all virtual from the comfort of your own homes. So, I hope my screen is visible to all.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So let's start today. Good evening to all. There are few objectives for today's webinar, which we plan to have at the end of the lecture. We will be dealing with certain of these objectives, and I would like to take some questions from the delegates on hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. Basically, it's actually a spectrum of diseases, disease conditions, which are very peculiar to pregnancy, and they pose a very unique situation such that since it is a very high risk pregnancy, and we are at the same time dealing with two lives, as you all know, the baby and the mother. So treating a non-pregnant hypertensive crisis and treating a hypertensive emergency in pregnancy are somewhat different, somewhat challenging. And we need to know clinically what exactly it is that separates the pregnant hypertensive from the non-pregnant hypertensive. So the looking at some of the objectives, we want to define hypertension, then classify, list the criteria. We need to be able to understand how to diagnose severe preeclampsia and HELLP syndrome. And we will discuss few current management considerations and understand and discuss the effects of hypertension on the baby and the mother. So as we all know, we are dealing with two lives. By definition, I'm sure you all know, it is a sustained blood pressure elevation of 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury. This BP is to be measured preferably by your routine mercury sphygmomanometer. Nowadays, the digital BP apparatuses are very much in trend, but let me tell you a word of caution. It's difficult to calibrate these digital apparatuses, and you may end up having a wrong reading, false high or false low. So in case of any doubt, it's always better to clarify, to check it once again with the mercury sphygmomanometer. A cuff size has to be proper. During pregnancy, the most ideal condition, the ideal posture of measuring blood pressure is by seating the patient in a chair. When the patient lies on her lies supine, there may be a false low reading, which we call a supine hypotension. So it's a good idea to always check her BP in sitting position. Maybe let us rest for about 10 minutes so that you rule out any stress related to white collar hypertension. And then after 10 minutes rest, you can check her blood pressure. And it is always the fifth Korotkov sound that we take into consideration, which is disappearance of the sound, and not the fourth one, that is muffling. As per the ACOG guidelines, we have hypertensive disorders which are associated in pregnancy categorized into four major categories. The most important and most unique for pregnancy, and which is directly related to us as obstetricians, is the preeclampsia-eclampsia syndrome, which includes all the severe complications, and HELLP syndrome, which is again a very unique syndrome of this preeclampsia-eclampsia syndrome. Then the second category would be a patient who is chronic hypertensive. I'll be just telling in short about each of these. Then the third one would be chronic hypertension with superimposed preeclampsia. And the last one is a gestational hypertension. So these are the four main categories of this spectrum. So what is preeclampsia? The old nomenclature was pregnancy-induced hypertension. But nowadays it's better called as preeclampsia. That is a condition which is prior, before eclampsia, before she throws a fit or before she has a convulsion. That's what is called as preeclampsia. It is associated most importantly with proteinuria. This is the unique defining factor of preeclampsia. A raised blood pressure and protein in the urine is equal to preeclampsia. And how much protein do we need? We typically do a 24-hour quantitative analysis. And anything above 300 milligrams in a 24-hour urine sample is a significant proteinuria, good enough to define that patient as a preeclamptic. In severe cases, you can also get in severe preeclampsia, you may also get proteinuria to the tune of 5 grams in a 24-hour urine sample, which is a massive protein loss. So keep it in mind. Nowadays, we get those dipsticks also for a bedside assessment. It's a semi-quantitative assessment in which there is a color change on that strip related to the level of the proteinuria, which is not very sensitive. But if you don't have anything else or you want a quick diagnosis, you can go ahead with that. That's not a very ideal thing to do. Then associated disorders with preeclampsia include thrombocytopenia, impaired liver functions, new onset renal insufficiency, pulmonary edema, and cerebral and visual disturbances. Our second category of ACOG was chronic hypertension. So this is a patient in who has been hypertensive when she was not even pregnant. So this hypertension predates pregnancy, and it has been diagnosed before the 20th week of pregnancy. So mind you, every time a pregnant lady shows up at your office, it's essential that you check her blood pressure and rule out that she is not a chronic hypertensive. The third category is a chronic hypertension with superimposed preeclampsia. So it's like a double trouble. You already have a chronic hypertension and essential hypertension, and 20 weeks ke baad mein, she is going to have superimposed preeclampsia. That is, proteinuria is going to step in. And the last one is the gestational hypertension, in which this is purely hypertension, which is diagnosed after 20 weeks. So by definition, this becomes a gestational, that is a pregnancy-related hypertension, but there is no proteinuria and there are no other systemic findings. So criteria for preeclampsia, as I already said, the two main criteria, defining criteria, would always be the blood pressure and the proteinuria. A blood pressure has to be above 140 systolic, 90 diastolic. And please don't go on the basis of a single reading and start treating your patients. Please give them benefit of doubt. Request your patients to come over after 6 hours. Maybe aap subah ki OPD mein dekhi ho, to sham ki OPD mein unhe review kar lijiye. 6 hours later, just see whether she's again hypertensive, and then you can safely label her as preeclampsia. And it has to be accompanied by a proteinuria. So quantitative analysis of protein samples, urine samples, is going to be essential if you want to label a patient as a preeclamptic. For severe preeclampsia, similar two characters remain, but the spectrum of those, the blood pressure becomes higher, that is 160 by 110 and above. Then there could be thrombocytopenia, so you need to know her platelets. Anything less than 1 lakh per millimeter cube would be thrombocytopenia. Liver function deranged, that is the AST or ALT deranged, or she has epigastric pain or right upper quadrant tenderness. These could be causing because of pain, stretching of the liver capsule because of edema. Then progressive renal insufficiency, serum creatinine which is on the rise, or serum uric acid which is on the rise. This could be showing renal insufficiency. Pulmonary edema, on clinical examination, you could get bilateral basal crypts. That is the first sign of pulmonary edema. And then you can check with SpO2, which would be going down. New onset cerebral or visual disturbances. A very common complaint she will come is with headache or visual scotomas. She will be saying that I can only see in the center. The peripheral vision seems to be impaired. Please take it seriously. Please check her blood pressure, her protein level, and follow her up later. The risk factors for preeclampsia, we all know, primiparity or even primipaternity. If she has a second marriage, the first child from that second husband, that pregnancy, she can again develop preeclampsia. Multifetal gestations, maternal age over 35 years, a history of preeclampsia in a previous pregnancy, the second pregnancy becomes a high-risk one. A chronic hypertensive, if she gets a superimposed preeclampsia, again, it's a super high-risk pregnancy. Pre-gestational diabetes, vascular disorders, nephropathies, antiphospholipid syndrome, obesity, and racial factors. So all in all, morbidity and mortality is supposed to be quite significant, and that's the reason we are even talking about hypertension in pregnancy, classifying it, discussing the management, and taking it very seriously. There is no such thing as a casual approach to be taken if even one reading of your patient comes out to be high. You need to be on alert. You don't need to panic. You don't need to scare her, but you need to be alert and monitor her more carefully. The pathophysiology, this is a very theoretical part. I won't go too much into details. There are these five or six theories which are put forth, but we don't know for sure which of them works actually most significantly. It could be interplay of various factors. In fact, all of these factors interplaying together causing this type of rise in the blood pressure. So basically, it's vasospasm. There is a contraction of uterine vessels and all the capillaries and all the blood vessels, which is causing rise in blood pressure. Then inadequate maternal vascular responses, where the when trophoblastic invasion is occurring, the maternal arterioles are not losing their muscular cells, and they are still there, and they are very much sensitive to all those kallikreins and serotonins and all the neurotransmitters which increase the blood pressure. So they go into response and lead to increased blood pressure. Then hemostasis problem, increased platelet activation, endothelial fibronectin levels are increased, and there is basically a procoagulant kind of a state. Then prostanoid balances are also, the prostaglandin, the prostacycline, thromboxane balance is shifted in favor of thromboxane A2. Thromboxane A2, we know, is a basically a procoagulant. So that again leads to problems related to PIH. Endothelium derived factors and lipid peroxide related vascular injuries. Why is hypertension important in pregnancy? So although we are not very sure of the pathophysiology, we are very sure of the problems that pathophysiology causes. And it, as you can see, it affects almost all the vital organs, the heart, blood, brain, lungs, liver, everything, kidneys, everything. And of course, last but not the least, the baby. So it is essential that we take it very seriously, because anytime your labeled mild case could make a rapid turnover to become a severe preeclamptic. Cardiovascular changes, there is hypertension, there is increased cardiac output, there is increased systemic vascular resistance. So the treatment which we will be giving is related to address these issues, these problems, these pathophysiologic changes. That's why it's essential that you know these changes which are happening in each system. In hematological effects, there is volume contraction or hypovolemia, but there is elevated hematocrit. How is this clinically relevant? See, if you are getting a preeclamptic, but her hemoglobin shows 12 grams, it's a false positive high. It's not that she is not anemic. She may need blood, and it would be prudent, a good clinical practice point, if you arrange blood for her whenever she is due for her labor or cesarean or whatever. Thrombocytopenia, we already know it is one of the risk factors. The most important thing we find here is because there is leakage of fluid and collection of fluid from the intravascular compartment into the third space. So there is a lot of edema. There is pedal edema, there is sacral edema, there is facial puffiness. Very typically, your patient will tell in the morning when she wakes up, her ring is tight. So this is showing there is swelling all over her body. This whole body swelling is called as anasarca. So this third spacing of fluid causes these hematologic changes, which need to be understood when you are giving transfusions to the patient. Also, when you are dealing with anesthesia, because there could be sudden hypotension when you give her a spinal anesthesia before you take her up for a C-section. The neurologic effects, we all know, it starts with headache, and the most significant of it would be seizures. That is convulsions, that is eclampsia. Pulmonary edema again poses a very important, very serious and very grave complication. That's again because of capillary leak into the interstitial spaces behind the alveoli, which leads to pulmonary edema. Then renal effects, there is decreased GFR, which we can see with oliguria as one of the presenting factors. There could be pre-renal azotemia, frank oliguria, patient could present with acute tubular necrosis and could actually go towards renal failure. And fetal effects, placental abruption, which is again very serious, growth restriction, fetal growth restriction, oligohydramnios, fetal distress, and perinatal morbidity and mortality increased due to various factors interplaying all at once. So how do we manage these cases? The ultimate cure is delivery, as we all know. So this whole thing, the main culprit which we look at is the placenta. So till the placenta is in place, this you're not actually going to be able to completely treat your PIH. You will only be able to manage it by reducing the hypertension, reducing the side effects, the complications, giving her steroids, trying to prolong the pregnancy till such a condition that it is viable for the baby. But the ultimate cure is delivery. So when you are posed with a situation where you have to decide between whether to look at the baby or the mother, like if it's a high-risk patient and she is far from term, you have to look at the mother first. Don't worry about the baby. The ultimate cure is delivery, remember. Assess her gestational age, assess the cervix, assess the fetal well-being, do the lab tests, rule out severe diseases, rule out complications, do the investigations for her complications. All clinical, laboratory, and radiologic imaging, whichever is needed, has to be done, has to be in place. This is going to help you make a diagnosis, not miss a diagnosis, and be medico-legally safe as well. So these form the crux of any management of any hypertensive patient in pregnancy. Now coming to the timing of delivery, another very baffling question always, when to deliver? See, if she's a chronic hypertensive, if she's an essential hypertension only, you can safely take her up to 39 to 40 weeks of gestation. That is a full term, unless she has associated any other obstetric indication. She can carry on towards still full term. If she is a gestational hypertension where there is no proteinuria, or she is a preeclampsia without severe features, which is just a mild preeclamptic, mild proteinuria, just a 130/90 or a 140/90 blood pressure, you put her on medicines and she is well controlled, then don't wait till term. At 37 completed weeks of gestation, you induce her or you take her up for an elective C-section. But if she's a severe preeclamptic, at 34 weeks also, anytime beyond 34 weeks, you can induce her. If she comes in early onset preeclampsia, then you have to deliver the patient immediately if you see that the patient would be unstable or there could be impending complications which could be threatening to her life. Then you don't need to think about the viability or the gestational age of the baby. Of course, nowadays with our NICUs being so well equipped, the all babies, even 32, even 28 weekers, stand a good chance of survival. But what we need to do here as obstetricians is, first and foremost, treat the patient, treat her complications, stabilize her, remove the baby. Baby will be taken care of in the NICU. You need to save the mother first. For a viable fetus which is preterm, give steroids. But do not delay delivery for preeclampsia with severe features complicated by any of the following. So if she is in an uncontrolled age, she is in a hypertensive crisis or an accelerated hypertension, or she is in eclampsia, she's thrown a convulsion, she has pulmonary edema, abruption, DIC, or if the antepartum fetal surveillance is not showing you a reassuring pattern, or there is an IUFD already, then please do not wait for the steroids to act. Please remove the baby as soon as possible. After steroid administration, you can have up to 48 hours delay if the maternal condition is slightly stable and the fetal condition is also slightly stable. If we have a preterm PROM, or she is already in labor, or she just has a thrombocytopenia, she has abnormal liver function tests, IUGR is not very, it's just a mild IUGR, mild oligohydramnios. So these are the conditions where you may wait. The earlier slide was where even if you give a steroid, you're not expected to wait for the steroids to act for 48 hours to go, because that could create further complications to you in terms of the mother's health. The route of delivery, again, it is your good judgment, the patient's situation, and you have to decide on several factors. Most importantly, it is determined by the gestational age, the presentation of the baby, cervical status, what is the Bishop score, maternal condition, and fetal condition. So all these factors you have to do some quick thinking, take into consideration her sonography, take into consideration her Doppler, take into consideration her lab reports, and then decide the route of delivery. Now coming to a little bit about the seizure prophylaxis. Is there anything in way which you can do to prevent seizures? So there is a situation called as imminent eclampsia. Imminent means about to happen, eclampsia. The patient is such that her look is such or her parameters are such that she may throw a fit anytime, and you don't want that. So you are going to give her something which is going to stop that seizures from happening actually. And that something, that very good novel drug for a prophylaxis of eclampsia, is magnesium sulfate. It is the drug of choice, absolutely. It's like a crowned king of the entire armamentarium of treatment of eclampsia. So basically, magnesium sulfate is not a hypotensive agent. We are using it as an anticonvulsant here. And how it acts is by stopping the neuromuscular stimulation. So this hypertensive crisis in which the patient is, there is a cerebral irritability. And once the neurons start firing rapidly, that's when she is going to throw a fit. And that's where we have to stop it. So the recommended dose for prophylaxis is a bolus IV of about 4 grams of magnesium sulfate. This is similar as the preacher's regime, but only difference between the actual treatment of eclampsia and prophylaxis is that you do not need to give those intramuscular doses, the 5 grams deep intramuscular doses which is given in preacher's regime. That is not necessary. In imminent eclampsia, where you're giving for prophylaxis, you only give the bolus dose, a 4 grams bolus IV. Give it slowly, push it without dilution. So if you are having a 50% ampule, you will need about 4 ampules in that comes to about 8 ml of the drug, and push it slowly over 5 to 10 minutes, always checking for her respiratory rate and always keeping an ampule of calcium gluconate by your side. If not, if you have an access to a syringe pump or an infusion pump, a better technique to do is to put her on a 1 to 2 gram per hour rate of an infusion. So that kind of gives a good smoother control and a longer control. And you could actually carry forward for about 4 to 6 hours and very safely deliver her in that time. This is all magnesium sulfate prophylaxis for imminent eclampsia. If she is in eclampsia already, then after this bolus dose, you deliver your patient. And then for 24 hours after the first convulsion in an antepartum or in a postpartum, 24 hours after the last convulsion, you are supposed to continue the 5 grams deep intramuscular maintenance dose. Is that clear? At every time before you inject the intramuscular, you have to check her blood pressure, her urine output, her respiratory rate, and the deep tendon reflexes. This has to be done absolutely religiously. Please do not take this drug very easy, because it can create problems. Like, you will save her from a convulsion, but you'll actually put her into respiratory arrest. Doesn't make any sense. So you have to see whether her deep tendon reflexes are there or not, whether she's having hyperreflexia. That again is a red flag. You need to stop the withhold the next dose. Or deep tendon reflexes are down. They are not present, they are absent. Respiratory rate, it has to be above 18 breaths per minute. And a urine output, at least 25 ml per hour. So every 4 hours, if you are giving that intramuscular dose, between those two doses, she should have passed minimum 100 ml of urine. If the urine output is less than 100 ml, please withhold the dose. Let her come back to normal. Maybe the renal function is going down. Maybe she's dehydrated. Just check her hydration status. And then think about giving the next dose or not. The serum levels of 6 to 8 milligrams are considered to be therapeutic. But you don't need to assess the serum magnesium levels while you're treating. You can only check by these three parameters which you're seeing, the blood pressure. And you will be able to see clinically also that the patient is responding very well to this drug. This, I think I've already covered, so I won't go again. treatment of eclampsia, again, I've already covered. See, this eclampsia, although it is just a convulsion, and nowadays we know how to manage patients with convulsions, maternal mortality can happen. And that could be an extremely serious situation. So it's essential that you treat your patients of eclampsias in setups or in ICUs, obstetric critical care units, where you have an entire team working. It's not just the obstetrician. You need to have an intensivist who can intubate, who can put her on a ventilator, who can start magnesium sulfate, or if needed, she needs to be knocked down, she needs to be made unconscious with medicines. Those things need to be available. So it's prudent, it's good clinical practice to treat patients of eclampsia in an APEX institute or in an obstetric critical care unit. The problems with intubation in these patients is there is laryngeal edema always, because as we know, there is always a leakage of proteins into the third space. So there is edema everywhere. All the tissues in the body are edematous. So this poses a great challenge to intubation of such patients and then to ventilate them further. So the size of the intubation tube which you're going to need, the way in which you're going to secure airway, this has to be, you know, it's a very specific and very expertise kind of a job. It's not just that any random person can do it. Any random person should not do it, in fact. We need to respect a mother's life and give her the best possible treatment that that we can. So these are just a few points that I wanted to highlight in treatment of eclampsia. Then if there is some reservations against MaxSelf, there are alternative anticonvulsants also. We could put her on a nitroglycerin infusion drip, which also reduces the blood pressure, which also acts as an anticonvulsant. But mind you, it's not a very convenient and a very comfortable drug in pregnancy, where we want to have the baby. So because it passes through the placenta and it can create some problems to the baby. The other anticonvulsants are diazepam, sodium amytal, pentobarbital, and dilantin. Depending upon your ICU and your intensivist choice, any of these could be used in place of MaxSelf. After seizure, what we are supposed to do? Once the seizure has happened and you have already given MaxSelf, and then you are trying to shift the patient or give her better treatment, if you're not in an APEX institute yourself, you need to see her lab parameters. You need to assess the baby, because during convulsion, there is an episode of acute fetal hypoxia. So after that convulsion has passed off, once patient starts ventilating, you have to assess what is the effect that has happened to the baby during those few minutes. If the baby seems fine, it's very good, you get time. If the baby is compromised, or God forbid, unfortunately, if there is already an IUD, your treatment patterns will be totally different. So you need to assess the fetal well-being. Then effect delivery. As we all know, the ultimate cure of hypertensive syndromes is delivery. And for eclampsia, it's definitely rapid delivery. The only way is to get her into an emergency C-section, unless she is presenting to you with a head at perineum, where the baby is just going to be delivered out very soon. So that's a different story. Then transport the patient. That's what I was trying to tell, that whenever you are faced with an eclampsia, after the initial airway securing and coming back and checking whether the house the baby, you need to transfer her from your setup or from her house to a setup where she will get this team, this obstetric critical care unit. And no need for immediate cesarean, because many times it's just a single convulsion. Patient's Bishop score is very good. She may deliver very fast. So it's not that as soon as she is having a convulsion, she is to be taken for C-section. No. But a word of caution is she has to be delivered ASAP as soon as possible. There is no role of now you assess, now it's an undilated cervix, now you induce, now you give her a trial, 12 hours, 16 hours, and till that time you put her on anticonvulsant, she may convulse again. Then you may lose a baby. So these are not acceptable. So use your judgment and see to it that she is delivered fast, very fast. that all hypertensive emergencies in anything which is not, which is short of a convulsion, but which is accelerated hypertension, something like 220 by 120 BP, 220 by 180 BP. There are conditions where patients present like that. You have to treat her in an ICU. Have to. It is underlined. Have to treat her in an ICU setup with monitoring of the baby. You treat her on IV treatments, IV drugs. IV hydration has to be minimal. See, these preeclamptic patients are very prone to go into pulmonary edema. So just rapidly transfusing her IV fluids is not a good idea to do. The actual dosage for IV fluids is not more than 75 to 85 ml an hour if you want to transfuse. The only transfusion she is going to need is if she needs blood, plasma, platelets, and if she needs IV fluids, crystalloids, then it's going to be in the range of about 75 to 85 ml an hour, not more than that. See to it that you keep your patient slightly on the drier side rather than putting her into overhydration and subsequent pulmonary edema. Criteria for treatment of hypertensive emergencies: raised blood pressure, extremely raised blood pressure, and please, please, please. Now, this is the difference between a non-pregnant hypertensive crisis and a pregnant hypertensive crisis. In pregnant hypertensive crisis, please avoid rapid reduction in blood pressure. Please discuss this point with your intensivist, because it's going to affect the placental perfusion. It's going to affect the blood flow going to the baby. If you suddenly drop the mother's blood pressure, the baby may actually suffer from asphyxia. So you have to reduce it very slow and not too low. You can, about diastolic blood pressure, about 100 to 90 should be your goal. Don't try to bring it down to 80 or 70. It's not necessary and it's actually counterproductive. Key steps for using vasodilators. Vasodilators are drug of choice, in fact, for hypertensive crisis, hypertensive emergencies in pregnancy. The most important drugs are hydralazine, labetalol, and nifedipine, of which labetalol is my favorite. It's given orally and also as an IV. IV labetalol through a syringe pump or an infusion pump has an extremely good control of blood pressure. It's an alpha beta blocker. It does not affect the baby. It does not affect the baby's fetal heart rate. And you can actually at minute to minute control the blood pressure levels and titrate the speed of your infusion. It's that good a drug. So please give it a shot if you are faced with a hypertensive crisis in pregnancy. Nifedipine, again, 10 milligrams per oral is the dosage. Please do not give it sublingual. It used to be a myth to poke those slide tablets and put them sublingual, which is supposed to be giving an effect as good as an IV, but it leads to precipitous fall of blood pressure, again, hampering the placental perfusion, hampering the blood flow to the baby. So it's not necessary. It's not indicated. A per oral absorption is on onset of action is also very fast. It's about 10 to 15 minutes and it will be very rapid. The response will be very good. So give your nifedipine tablets orally, not sublingual. Then some other complications which hypertensive crisis may present in pregnancy are pulmonary edema, oliguria, a persistent hypertension, and DIC. Now all of these in itself are separate lectures. So much has been studied about it and so much can be said that maybe if there are certain questions in the chat box, in the question answer, then we'll take it over. But otherwise, these are the other important complications which we need to take care of. I'll just go through it very, very quickly. Pulmonary edema is basically fluid overload. It's an indication of fluid overload. So as I said, 75 to 85 ml an hour, not more than that. That's the rate of infusion which you need to give. Treatment is avoiding overhydration. And a good drug of choice to relieve pulmonary edema is IV Lasix, about 20 milligrams IV. You could even repeat it after 2 hours or 3 hours if her response, she's not responding well. And it improves pulmonary edema very well. Oliguria, again, 25 to 30 cc per hour is acceptable, as I already said. Even at the time of your max self dosaging, 25 ml per hour is the rule of thumb. Lasix is not necessary. And postpartum diuresis in these patients is very common. See, as we already know, it's the basically the placenta which is the culprit. Once the placenta is removed, all the neurotransmitters fall in place. All the fluid shifts happen. Fluid shifts, in fact, happen within the first 24 hours. Suddenly, you will realize her face looks less swollen. Her hands look less swollen. Her feet look less swollen because diuresis has started happening. Fluid has shifted from third space into intravascular compartment, and she will be passing a lot of urine. Persistent hypertension. Now, a percentage of cases will still present to you postpartum during their follow-up, and you will realize that they still have blood pressure raised. So now these go on, they are graduated now to the class of essential hypertension, which is going to now pose a risk for the subsequent pregnancy. So you need to counsel your patients, put them on proper medications with which they will have a good control, lesser complications, and which will be safe during breastfeeding for the year, at least the few months to come afterwards. So this counseling in these patients is extremely crucial. DISE is a very, very risky and potentially fatal complication of hypertension if left untreated and if left undiagnosed. So a high index of suspicion for DISE is supposed to be essential for a treating obstetrician. A very first early symptom of DISE would be hematuria. If you see hematuria in your urobag, please be on an extreme alert and see to it that she may be going into DISE. DISE many times is very unforgiving because we diagnose it late, and we may miss a patient after taking care of all her hypertension, the seizures, the prophylaxis, the baby, the cesarean. But in postpartum period, if she develops DISE, you may actually lose a mother. So we need to be ultra careful about that. Anesthesia issues, this has to be discussed with the parents, with the relatives, and also with the patient. Most ideal for a patient who is an imminent eclampsia or who is on a hypertensive crisis, most ideal would be to give her a general anesthesia. But a combined spinal epidural, a CAC as we call it, or a CLE as we call it, is also good because the epidural gives you a long-term pain relief. Onset of action is very smooth, so there is no precipitous fall of blood pressure as in simple spinal is there. In GA, somehow, if she is in a hypertensive crisis, general anesthesia will give you better control of her ventilation and her cardiac parameters. So since you have intubated the patient, the entire thing is in your hands, in your control. So that way, general anesthesia is anytime better. But if she is under magnesium sulfate prophylaxis and not having any other complications, you may safely go ahead with the combined spinal epidural approach. HELLP syndrome. Now, this is another very interesting and very unique complication of pregnancy-related hypertension. HELLP is an acronym of hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelet. This unique combination presents itself typically during hypertension in pregnancy. How do we diagnose it? For hemolysis, you need to do a serum LDH level, has to be raised more than 600 units. A CBC, C for a platelets, it has to be less than 1 lakh, and an LFT. The AST level should be anything more than 70, or actually anything double. If the liver enzymes are deranged more than 2 times the normal, you should be on an alert. But elevated liver enzymes and low platelets and hemolysis, this together is again a very very dicey situation. It could be a very challenging, and it could turn potentially fatal. So you need to be on an alert again to watch out for HELLP syndrome. How can we prevent hypertension? Well, there are certain studies which say low dose aspirin in about 75 milligrams per daily dose, starting from preconception, in fact, or at the very first visit that you meet a patient and you realize that she could be a high risk for developing PIH, please start her on prophylaxis with low dose aspirin. It has been shown to be quite effective. Then there are certain studies with high dose calcium or vitamin C or vitamin E supplementation. No side effect, but you can always try giving those things. And I think that about almost sums up a lot of things about hypertension in pregnancy. So if we are done with the lecture, I would like to take questions if there are any.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for the wonderful talk. It is always an honor and learning to hear you, ma'am. Ma'am, if you allow me, then we'll take the questions. Ma'am, we have a first question. That is there any specific nutrition to postpone the eclampsia in second trimester?
Nutrition wise, as I already said, high dose calcium and vitamin C and E supplementations have had some effect, but there is no randomized controlled trial where we can specifically say that, okay, this is the thing, this is the incrementing factor, this deficiency creates preeclampsia, this deficiency creates eclampsia, nothing like that. Basically, right from early preconception, see to it that your pregnant ladies or your ANC patients have a good level of hemoglobin, give them calcium supplements and put them on a protein diet, protein supplementation, a protein powder or tablets or sachets, whatever you prefer in your practice. Please try to do that, because typically our foods, our Indian foods are always deficient in proteins and calcium. So I feel that forget eclampsia, forget preeclampsia, even if we as a routine give them iron, calcium and a protein, I think we would be solving a lot of other complications also in pregnancy.
Thank you very much, ma'am. We have one more question. During antenatal period, if BP is high and not controlled by single drug, role of combination of antihypertensive drugs?
So, yes, as I said, now the is your question complete? Is there anything more?
No, ma'am. That's all.
Yeah. So it was about the combination drugs, right?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So basically, the more important deciding factor here is the range of blood pressure and the gestational age of the patient. See, if you're looking at a patient who is at 36, 37 weeks, then and she's not getting controlled by one drug, might as well actually induce her at that time. Okay, rather than keeping on adding drugs. But if she's far from term, then you have to look at various other parameters. A very good first line drug used to be alpha methyl dopa. For some reason, it has been removed out of the market. But if not that, then nowadays, another very good drug with very good control is labetalol. I mean, I vouch for labetalol. It has an extremely smooth control and minimal side effects to the baby in the during pregnancy. So you can start safely with tablet labetalol, 100 milligrams OD, increase it to BD. If it does not improve, then you may add calcium channel blockers. You can add Nicardia retard or nifedipine peroral, something like that. And if on two drugs, on three drugs with high dose also she is not getting controlled, then this you have to keep monitoring her with her radiology and her clinic and lab investigations, and see to it that there is, you should keep in mind that at any time she may develop a complication or the baby may develop a complication, and be prepared that you may need to terminate this pregnancy prematurely in view of safety of the mother.
Thank you very much, ma'am. We have one more question. Is there any means to prevent eclampsia during third trimester of pregnancy?
Yes, absolutely. Stringent control and monitoring of your preeclamptic patient is crucial. You cannot say that 130-90 hi hai ya proteinuria humne dekha hi nahi, kuch nahi hota, dawai liye nahi liye. No, that doesn't matter. If you are not admitting your patient, you please follow her up every 3 days, every week for BP control, for her lab tests, every 2 weeks for her sonography and Dopplers. Please monitor her extremely carefully. That is the first thing as obstetricians we need to understand, that any mild hypertensive may at any time go to a severe hypertensive or a complicated hypertensive. So blood pressure, take it seriously. That is the rule of thumb. How to prevent eclampsia? If you, as I said, there is a condition called imminent eclampsia. So where there are, the patient is having headache, warning signs and symptoms of headache, blurring of vision, or epigastric pain, or she has thrombocytopenia, or she has reduced fetal movements. These are all warning signs and symptoms. If she presents with high blood pressure and any of these signs and symptoms, be on an alert that, okay, she may get into an eclampsia. Now that's the time you need to start your Maxell prophylaxis, assess the patient, assess her gestational age, the baby's well-being, decide whether you want to deliver her, you want to do a C-section. And please talk all these things periodically, every time with your patient and your and their relatives. Take consent, be medico-legally safe. Because these are all high-risk cases, these land up in ICUs. If God forbid, it lands up in a mortality, you need to have your documentation all in place, which you have been trying, you have explained to them, and this is the unfortunate side effect that you lost a mother or whatever. So this all forms the gamut, the entire spectrum of the management of a hypertensive patient.
Thank you, ma'am. We have one more question, ma'am. How frequently we have to monitor uterine umbilical artery Doppler if pulsatile index is elevated in a preeclampsia patient?
It would be prudent to do it every week. And again, it depends upon the gestation at which you are finding the thing. So if it is near term, please don't wait for a mishap to happen. See, if you have carried her through 36 weeks, 37 weeks, and then you have an IOD on hand at 37 weeks, it is unpardonable. So don't wait unnecessarily. Use your clinical judgment. See if the patient profile, see what the area in which you are practicing, and then go ahead with your decisions.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, there are no more questions from the delegates. If you allow, we'll close the webinar. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your wonderful talk and also for your valuable time. We look forward for your continuous support from the for the upcoming educational activities as well. Thank you very much, ma'am. Many thanks.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, ma'am, and also thank all the delegates who are participating in this.